If my patients have grapefruit juice, is that messing up their medications?
Find out today on Medical History Mysteries.
In previous medical history mysteries, you have shared with us that we should review our patient's medication list, make sure that they know the dosages that they're supposed to take, and us ask if they've taken them. Now I think we're taking this another step. There's foods and beverages that can change the, what would you say, the mechanism of action or the efficacy of medications. Can you share a little bit about that?
All right, Pam, but we're going to make this drug interactions for dental pharmacology light, okay? Like a one-on-one course, because we can really get into the weeds really quickly with drug interactions, and there's so many of them. So let's start off by saying, do yourself a favor as a clinician and invest in a drug interaction checker software, okay? Lexicomp, whatever you want to use. I don't have one in particular that I'm promoting. I'm just saying find one out there that works for you. And do your due diligence and make sure that you're looking at the medications the patient's taking along with what you're going to use today in practice, and make sure there's no outwardly obvious drug interactions, okay? And then dig a little deeper into that software to see not just the significant interactions, but some of the moderate interactions that might matter as well. Minimal or those types of interactions, as the name suggests, really aren't that problematic. You're looking for significant to moderate. Okay, but let's say you don't have access to a drug interaction checker right then and there. Are there some easy things to remember about which drugs and which foods sort of mess up things for us in dentistry, or mess up drugs in general? So let's go over them, okay? If you had asked me, okay, give me one recreational drug that I'd be concerned about as far as causing drug interactions, I would say to you, tobacco. Okay, it's no secret that cigarette smoke has been engineered in a way to keep us smoking, to make us want to smoke more. You know, some of the ingredients in cigarette smoke speed up liver enzymes, which make us break down nicotine faster so that we want to smoke again, right? I mean, that's everything I've understood anecdotally about cigarette smoke. Okay, so if your patient's a smoker, it's likely that they're going to break down drugs like opioids and painkillers and maybe even local anesthesia faster than you might think. Okay. If you ask me, okay, give me the name of a dietary supplement that causes drug interactions, my answer would be St. John's wort. If I had to just pick one, okay, you take St. John's wort, I'm going to say that if you just took a look at St. John's wort information that's available currently. Now, remember, it's a dietary supplement. It's not a drug. It's not approved by the FDA. So again, there's information out there that's kind of sketchy, if you want to call it that, because it's not something I can say is given the seal of approval by the US FDA. But from the information that is available, St. John's wort probably interacts with more medications than most medications. So if your patient's taking St. John's wort, I'd be, again, a little more concerned, specifically because it does have some of that serotonin-like activity. So if you're going to use a drug like tramadol, let's say, to treat their pain, but they're also taking St. John's wort, and by the way, they're also taking Seroquel in addition to their antidepressant. Wow, that's a lot of serotonergic activity that could lead to bad things happening. So okay, St. John's wort would be my pick as the number one dietary supplement to be cautious of. If you're going to ask me, give me a food or something like that that I would have no clue, right? I would say it's going to be hard to give you something you'd have no clue about. I'll give you something you probably know about, but maybe never thought about it very much, and that would be grapefruit juice, okay? So grapefruit juice has been known to interfere with liver enzymes and to prolong the activity of certain drugs, especially things like the statins, right? Cholesterol medications. So because grapefruit juice is an enzyme inhibitor, it can make drugs last longer than they should. And again, I'd be worried about things like opioids and local anesthesia, although the pathway is not very clear. So I can't guarantee that if your patient swigs a half a gallon of grapefruit juice before they walk in your office, that it's going to affect the anesthesia at all. I'm just saying we think it's a possibility. We don't know all the pathways. So we say avoid grapefruit juice when you're taking medications. But it's not just the juice. It could be the fruit. It could be the grapefruit seed extract. So it's there's more to it than just that. And if you said to me, okay, give me one drug, just one drug that I have to remember as a dental professional that's going to cause a lot of drug interactions. Of all the drugs we use in dentistry, just give me one. I'd say it's diflucan, fluconazole. Fluconazole, again, interacts with lots of drugs. It can cause interactions with drugs from almost every different category that I've seen in some way or another. And diflucan has an effect on some of the medications that we use in dentistry, both directly and indirectly. Go ahead, Pam. You had a question. I wanted to hear it. Go ahead.
I got to play devil's advocate here because we're dental professionals. Our patients come in and they are on a list of medications. I would say maybe in school or in an ideal world, either the dentist, hygienist, or assistant can plug in all these medications and be like, okay, let me investigate drug-drug interactions for drugs that are already prescribed and the patient's already taking. Shouldn't this already have been done?
Well, and depends on who you ask to do it, you know, and depends on the state you're practicing in. Some states require that that utilization review be done by the pharmacist, but, you know, the pharmacist isn't there in the office with you when you're going to be administering a drug, right? Some states require you to do that review in advance of using medications in the office. But again, is it you or is it someone you delegated to? And what ultimate responsibility do you have if the person you delegated that task to, even if the state allows it, misses something or neglects to tell you, right? So I've always encouraged clinicians, if you're going to be the bus driver, you know, you're the one driving the bus, you should be doing all of those ancillary checks. Yes, you don't have a lot of time. Yes, you rely on your staff. I get it. But when it comes to something that like drug interactions that can be life-threatening, you may want to at least quick do a cursory review of their work to make sure that you took a set of eyes to it as well, just to make sure. Drug interactions aren't very common, but they're common enough that when you miss them, you often say afterwards, how did I miss that? And not only will you say that, so will your client and maybe the attorney that they hire to say the same thing later on. Why did you miss that? Didn't you take pharmacology in school? Or didn't you have a software you could use to determine that? So it's part of being that prudent dentist or hygienist, you know, and look, as a licensed professional, you know, even dental assistants in some states, being able to view that information and understand how to use it. And so I wanted to just breach the topic here to really raise awareness, because who would think that cigarette smoke, grapefruit juice, and something like that could interact with medications that we use in the practice of dentistry every day.
And definitely supplements. I can't even tell you how many people are on one or more supplements that they might even be self-prescribing. So you mentioned Lexicomp. Can you give us kind of a few that we could check out if in case we're not doing this in our practices?
The other one that I've seen used is Hippocrates. People seem to love it because it has that drug interaction checker. I'm assuming it still has it. I don't use one myself. And you can always look up the drug itself. I mean, if you're going to use, let's say, lidocaine, and you want to know what drugs are going to interact with it, you could, you know, look up lidocaine and find what are the drug interactions that are likely, and then do the spot check with the patient's medications. For example, one over-the-counter drug that interacts with lidocaine is the H2 receptor antagonist called Tagamet, cimetidine. Like its cousins Pepcid and Zantac, people use it to reduce acid production and therefore eat the food you love. We talked about that on a couple episodes. But bottom line is it can interact with lidocaine and make lidocaine last longer, not so much here at the injection site, but in other parts of the body where it can increase adverse reactions.
That's an interesting one, because I've seen on Facebook and, you know, different forums that if you have trouble, you know how you have like those, probably you can count on one hand, those patients that you cannot get numb, you know, you give them two blocks and now you're giving them buccal lingual and you're like, oh my gosh, I can't get them numb and I still have this work to do. And now I'm a half an hour or 45 or longer minutes behind and you can't get them numb. It's kind of, is it an old wives' tale when people are recommending that you give or tell your patient to take an antacid, like a Tums or something, the day before and the morning of their dental appointment to
It's
increase?
Absolutely unbelievable, Pam, because there's absolutely, in my mind, no evidence, no proof that that actually works. It's completely anecdotal, but I've seen it work. I don't know how, I don't know why, because how could the antacid that you chew up penetrate the tissue and manage the pH in any way whatsoever? I don't understand how it works, but I've seen it work. So yes, if you think it's going to work and if you think it's going to help, give it a try. What can you lose in that situation, as long as the patient's allowed to use antacids? And to your point before about supplements, you know, the easy ones to remember are the ones that start with a G. And I think we've gone over this before. So there's four G's, right? Garlic, ginger, ginseng, and ginkgo. All start with a G and all increase the risk of bleeding. It's not something we normally think about, but because bleeding is a necessary part of dentistry sometimes, these people can bleed more than you might think because they're not taking an anticoagulant, they're not taking an antiplatelet agent, but because they're taking these supplements, they might bleed more than you would think.
Oh, most definitely. We administer Botox in our practice, and every once in a while you get somebody who's on supplements and you get a bleeder.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes.
Wow. Okay. Well, you've given us a lot to think about. This was a big one. So thank you so much for your time and sharing that. And, you know, must be nice to be a human Hippocrates, because that's really good information to have.
It pushes the hair out of your head. Have you noticed?
Can you see mine's all intact? Yeah, that's great. All right, everybody. We will see you next week.
Thanks, everybody.
Be safe.
Bye.